most important things about feeder fishing is to set up and be as comfortable as possible with everything around you and everything handy. Because we're going to be continually filling the feeder, casting it, and of course accuracy in where you place that feeder, as always, plays a very, very important part. Everything has to be to hand. You keep nets positioned so that it's easy delivery from fish right into the mouth of the net. You don't have to get up and walk anywhere. Landing nets there, nice and handy. Ground bait, all my hook baits and the ground bait, because we will be continually filling that feeder and casting to the desired place once we've plumbed the depth and found out exactly where we are going to fish. And if we need any changes of terminal tackle, hooks, new feeders, whatever, everything's all there. Really, I shouldn't have to move from this seat for the full day's fishing. The ground bait I'm going to use today is in two parts. The one I'm going to actually use in the feeder is this one here, which is a very, very dry mix, which will explode out of the feeder once the feeder gets down there on the bottom. And the other ground bait here is exactly the same mix, but a little bit more water has been added, so it's a little bit more sticky, because I'm initially going to put about four or five balls of ground bait with this catapult out there in the swim, just to establish a bed of feed. The actual mix I'm using is a little bit of this, but half a bag of Coco Belge. The Coco Belge helps to fluff up the ground bait and speed it out of the feeder. The main ingredient of the mix is this 3000 Lake. There's about a packet and a half gone into this mix, and it's an absolute first-class ground bait. And of course, when there are bream about, then I wouldn't be without this brasm. It seems to pull fish from miles. And for particle movement, then a little bit of ground hemp, half a bag of ground hemp, seems to do the trick. All I need to do now is to add the baits which are laid out around me. And they are the pinkies, a few white maggots, and of course casters, because if there are any bream around, then it's always a great holding bait for bream, red maggots, and possibly the main hook bait of the day will be red worms. My method of assembling the terminal tackle is very, very easy. First, with the hook already on the line, and the hook I'm using, by the way, is a 39862. In fact, it's this one here with this blue-shaped hook. An ideal hook, especially for bream, with its little short shank and a slight reverse. However, if the fishing does hot up, then I'll change that hook to this particular one, which is a heavy feeder hook, and that's a particularly good hook on the river where you've got the flow to combat as well. But if the fishing really speeds up here, then I shall be changing to it even in this still water. With the hook already on the line, just pull about 3 or 4 foot of line away from the hook, and at that point, which is going to be the length of the tail, and I'm going to go for about a 4 foot tail to start with, then simply just tie a loop in the main line, just by doubling it like that. Make the loop about nine inches long. Just double the line like that and simply then just wet it so it holds together. Form a loop and pass the double line through the loop once and then twice. So we've simply now got a loop, my fingers in the loop, a loop on the main line. And then by removing that little bit of plastic off the feeder and bending the actual lead just forward a bit, you can then simply place that loop onto that bent lead, squeeze the lead back in place, and there's the feeder now firmly fixed on the line. And the beauty about this method, it doesn't tangle at all. And the other thing that I like about it, it's quick to change back from the feeder to a bomb, because sometimes you get the feeling that you're maybe introducing too much feed, and rather than continue feeding the swim, a quick change to the bomb is sometimes necessary. And to change to the bomb, all you do is bend the lead back again, take the loop off, twist the loop till the line almost becomes one, Then thread that through the eye of the bomb. Take the twist out of the loop and open the loop again. And simply thread the bomb through that loop. And there's a quick change to the bomb. In fact, I'm going to leave that bomb on because I'm going to use that on the countdown method to determine the depth of water out there. And by continually casting a little bit farther, I'll find just what we've got out there, and I shall be searching for a shelf or the deepest water at the bottom of the shelf. Because as already stated, it is quite shallow in the margins. To establish the depth of water we've got out there, it's a matter of counting the bomb down. That means after I've cast, by watching the rod tip, which will be slightly under compression, and counting it down, the number of seconds it takes for the lead to hit the bottom, and then the rod will straighten, I can then determine what depth I've got by multiplying the number of seconds it takes by approximately a foot and a half per second. So if I get a count of 4 seconds out there, that means I'm in about 6 foot of water. Let's have the first cast at about 20 yards and see what depth we've got. As you can see, the rod tip is now under compression and almost immediately drop back maybe about 3 seconds. So 3 times a foot and a half is about 4.5 foot of water. Let's have another cast just a little bit farther now and see if we've got any increase in the depth. This time I'm going to put it about 30 yards. Start to count it down. You see the rod under compression. That's 3, 4, 5 seconds. So 5 seconds now times a foot and a half, we're now into about 7.5 foot of water. So it appears there's quite a gradual shelf from 20 yards to 30 yards. Let's go a little bit farther and see what we've got now. This time I'm going to go for about another 10 yards. And count it down yet again. And now we've got an 8 second count at 40 yards. So 8 seconds, we're now into about 12 foot of water. Go a little bit farther again and see what happens again. This time I'm going to give it just that extra lurch and go for about 50 yards. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. 8 seconds again. So from 40 yards to 50 yards, the bottom now appears to be flat because we have the same count at 40 yards as we did at 50. So 40 yards is going to be an ideal distance to fish. We've got a gradual slope until it reaches about 12 or 13 foot of water at 40 yards. And then for the next 10 yards at least, it's a flat bottom. So I'm going to go for that flat bottom just at that 40 yard marker. Now, the easiest way to consistently hit that 40 yards is first of all to cast that distance. And then we're actually going to mark the line. I'll show you how. Let's just cast the 40 yards first. Let's just check that depth again, just to make sure we're right. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's it. And now what we do, if your reel has got a line clip, then by all means use that. If not, then simply put a rubber band around the spool of the reel, then wind the line over the rubber band. This reel has got a line clip, so take the spool off the reel, and then just wrap the line underneath that line clip. In fact, you can do it twice if you wish to be on the safe side. That means now that every cast, that restriction will drop that feed in exactly that same place. And providing we get a marker once again on the far bank that we can constantly aim at, then we're going to deposit that feed out of that feeder in exactly the same place every time, and of course That is the essence of all fishing, accuracy with your feed. And that's why the feeder is also a very, very popular method. It used to be called the leveller, because people, all right, before the feeder was invented, then it had to be the skill of depositing feed either by hand or with a catapult and then putting the bomb accurately on that feed. The feeder does that automatically for you because the hook is always in that area where the feeder is depositing its contents. It makes it a very, very simple method. Now we've established the distance out that we're going to fish, I'm going to change the bomb back to the feeder and we're ready then to start fishing. And that's one of the reasons why I like this method, because it's so simple. Just push the line through that swivel and take that loop of line back over the bomb. It's off so quickly. Hook the feeder back on and we're back in business. Before we lay any ground bait out there, you know, the four or five balls, the initial four or five balls with the whopper dropper catapult, it's worth just having one cast with the feeder just to see if there's any sign of fish already there. Because the worst thing you can do is to actually put four or five balls on top of an already existing shoal of bream. That could scatter them for the rest of the day. And if the bream are there, and hopefully we'll find out with one cast, looking for line bites and false bites as fish are rubbing against the line, or they may even take the baited hook, then all we need to do is just continually drip feed just by using the feeder. So it's always worth having one cast first, just before you decide there's no fish there and it's quite safe then to lay that carpet of feed with the catapult. Always bait the hook first before you actually fill the feeder. And I'm just going to try just a couple of red maggots to start with. And then add a few pinkies just to a corner of the ground bait here and a few casters into that area. And maybe just a taste of white and red maggots. With the hook baited, then just fill the feeder. Just drop the feeder in and then with finger and thumb from each end, just push this very, very dry ground bait in, into the feeder. And there it is, full and ready to cast out to that spot. And we're going to deliver that the 40 yards, which is restricted by a line clip, and aiming straight in front, I can guarantee putting that feeder on the same spot each and every time. Whilst it's sinking to the bottom, just hold the rod out over the water, watch for the compression, that 8 seconds, for the compression to come out of the rod, and then gently pull it back onto the rest and facing the target board. Tighten the line up a little bit so there's just a little bend in the tip and everything's set and ready for action. It's always worth having a target board because sometimes the bites are very, very tiny. Sometimes an eighth of an inch bite is enough, especially in the winter time when the fish are a little bit dour. Then they just seem to pick that bait up and sometimes the tip, it's almost as if the tip is alive. You get a little bit of movement in the tip from the conditions and all of a sudden sometimes it'll just freeze. And that marker board helps you to detect bites on the most difficult of conditions. Just a matter of waiting here now just to establish whether or not we've got a shoal of fish already out there. Well, that's been in there now a good 10 minutes and there's not been a flicker on that tip. I think we've established that there's no fish out there at the moment and therefore we're quite safe to go ahead with the bombardment. What I'm going to do is deposit about four or five balls of this stickier ground bait because it had that much, little bit more water added to it, and I'm going to put those four or five initial balls out and lay that bed of ground bait out there with the whopper dropper. It's too far for me to throw by hand and I find this particular catapult, the design of this catapult, helps to cushion or hold those balls. In fact, I'll just show you how it works. If I make a ball And the idea is to get accuracy, make all the balls the same size. If you make them as round as possible and keep them all the same size, then the same amount of pull on that catapult, then you should land them in the same place each and every time. But you can see the design of this catapult. You drop the ball in that cup, and then these slings almost form like a hammock and sort of hold the ball in position whilst you're ready to let go. Now, to actually fire the ground bait, the thing is to put your right arm straight, straighten that, let the elastic back to your shoulder, aim at your target through the forks, give it the right amount of elevation, and let go. And there you are, that's right on the spot. I'm going to put about five of those in. In fact, I'm going to make just another four up like that, ready. Keep them all the same size, and with the same pull on that catapult and the same elevation, then we should get them all accurately placed. Put that straight out in front, right on a bombardment of ground bait. And just hold the tip just a yard and a half or so away from the rod rest. Wait for that 8 seconds like that till that feeder hits the bottom, then draw the rod back, tightening up any surplus slack line and position it against our marker board. Just a little turn of the reel just to take that extra slack up. And now we can really expect a little bit of a wait before those fish arrive on that feed. I once remember a match on the River Welland where a well-known angler who was very, very successful at this method, fishing for bream, who drew just about four or five pegs away from where another chap was steadily catching bream. And the good angler just was off the shoal completely and was getting no bites. And whilst everybody was aware he was a good angler, he played on that. And what he did, in an effort to make the other man frighten his shoal away, he made three massive balls of ground bait, fired them high into the air with a great sploosh with each ball, sat down, stood in his tip, and then struck, pretending he had a bite, almost falling off his basket as to draw everybody's attention, and immediately put three more balls in, cast out again, sat there watching his tip again, and swore loudly as he missed the next bite. Of course, there wasn't a bite at all. And after he'd done that two or three times with three balls of ground bait, real three producers, the guy who was sat on the bream, the inexperienced angler who was sat on the bream, thought, well, if that's good for him, it's got to be good for me. And what did he do? He put three or four balls in. We're into a fish. But he put three or four balls in, frightened his shoal by putting those balls of ground bait on the fish's head. And of course, they could have gone in either direction. The direction they went in was the angler who knew what he was doing, who never put another ball in again, just relied on a little bit of feed in his feeder. And he stole the match off the guy who originally had the shoal. Well, that's a nice roach for the first fish. In fact, while I was talking to you, I did see the bite develop, but it's got it well down, it's going to be a disgorger job. It's simple to use a disgorger. All you do is hold the line tight, possibly in your mouth, or if the line is already tight to the tip of the rod, that will be sufficient. Just slip the disgorger, the slot in the disgorger, onto the line, push it down, just move it to one side, and the hook comes cleanly out, and the fish is safe and will live for another day. It didn't take long at all, really, just about 10 minutes like we anticipated for those fish to arrive. Unless it was just an odd one, but we'll have to wait and see. I'm going to go with just a couple of red maggots again on this light feeder hook. And by the way, I'm using a size 17 to a pound and three quarter, and the main line, the real line, is 3 pound. You need a fairly strongish line, continually throwing that feeder out that 40 yards. It's a fair bit of wear and tear on a line, and the last thing we want to do is for a breakage in our feeder to go out there unattached. Bait the hook always first, then fill the feeder. The idea of that is, of course, that if you fill the feeder first and then start to bait the hook, half the maggots and the squats, or the pinkies I should say, they've wriggled out of the feeder before we're ready to cast it. So always bait the hook first, and once again cast that out straight in front of us. Onto the spot. Hold the rod out over the water, let the feeder hit the bottom, watch for the rod end slackening as the feeder hits the bottom, draw it back, therefore tightening the line, and position it on our cross on the marker board. Take that little bit of slack line up, and always have just that rod just under a little bit of compression, so that drop back bites are also easy to spot. If the bites aren't coming, sometimes just by moving the bait, that attracts the fish's attention. And all you do is just get hold of the line near the first ring and just pull the feeder and therefore the hook just across the bottom in a tantalising manner. And just take that slack line up, and that often results in a bite fairly quickly. It's almost like if you put a ball of wool on the floor, I let the kitten into the room, it'll probably ignore that ball of wool. The minute you start to drag that ball of wool, then the kitten pounces. And fish often reply in the same way. Just add another little touch then, not worth striking at. Like just a little roach knock. Quite often that's the case on these mixed fisheries where you've got both bream and roach. Often the roach are first there on the feed, and bites can be fast and furious, and then all of a sudden the bites slow down. That feels like another roach. The bites will slow down from the roach as the bream arrive, and it's at that time, of course, when we change the hook, perhaps for a slightly bigger hook, the heavy feeder hook, and two or three worms, or a single worm, and a double caster, a worm and caster cocktail, is often the best bait. Oh, that's a good sign. I thought it was a skimmer, but it's not. That's a lovely little fish. That's a little hybrid, a sort of cross roach bream. You can see the sort of pinky coloured fins, not a true bream, but a mixture. When you cast the feeder, always make sure that you've got the same amount of line from the end of the rod to the feeder. And that way, with the same swing right straight ahead, you'll always maintain the right direction. I do find a sinking line is the best. And the easiest way to make a line sink is to prepare it the night before, simply by degreasing it, taking a spool off the reel and leaving it soaking overnight in a solution of washing up liquid and water. That's better. But feels like another roach. I mean, of course, it's possible that the bream aren't going to show up at all. One thing I can do, I can consider putting a bigger bait on to detract the roach from taking the bait so quickly. But then again, he is a beautiful roach. And very, very well worth catching. Well, that was a bite on the drop, so we've got it. Well, we had it. And pulled out of that one. There's no harm done, though. I mean, when you've got roach feeding like the way they're feeding now, then they don't shy off like bream do. And pulling out of the odd fish like that won't do any harm at all. Well, that one actually took the bait before it even reached the bottom. And in fact, that leads me into a very, very good method when roach fishing, when the fish are taking what we call taking on the drop. What I should be considering doing now is to extend the length of line between the feeder and the hook, where I've only got it about 3 foot at the moment. If I was to move the feeder, and that does mean actually setting the tackle again, you can imagine the feeder, before it hits the bottom, if I give the rod end a jerk and therefore empty that feeder into a cloud, then the hook, which is still five foot off the bottom, falling slowly in that cloud, you can expect bites before that hook bait reaches the bottom. To fish this on the drop method, I've rearranged the feeder, right, so it is now about 5 foot from the hook. That means I can empty the feeder 5 foot from the bottom and the hook will then descend naturally in and among that cloud of particles that have come out of the feeder. To do that, once again, we have to always bait the hook first. Fill the feeder, and once again, especially this time, this very, very dry ground bait, just dampened ground bait. Cast the feeder onto our mark. Now I know that it's an 8 second drop, so 3, 4, 5, empty the feeder, and watch immediately for a bite as it drops. There it goes, and it's on. You see how easy that method is? We've emptied the feeder about 5 foot from the bottom, and as that hook was falling among that cloud, then that roach intercepted the bait, and the bite was immediate. Because we know it's a count of 8 down there, I'm going to just count to 5 this time, which is 3, 4, 5. Empty the feeder, set the rod on the rest. As the feeder settles and the rod comes back under compression, and there's the bite registered right away. Well, this on the drop method is really, really working. Looks like we're going to fill our net with these roach. But I haven't lost confidence that the bream are not going to arrive. I've just got a feeling that It won't be long before they do. There's quite a delay in the bite coming this time. And even though I've had such a good run of roach, sort of fish one behind the other, I'm amazed that the bait hasn't been taken. And I've been waiting now, must be 2 minutes for a bite. This could be the sign that the bream have arrived. I've even got a lucky ladybird on my marker board there. How about that? Bound to get a bream now. Oh, look at that. Oh, just wait for it, wait for it. That's a definite bream. Never ever strike too early. Especially with that worm on. Give them plenty of time. Leave it. A lot of people can be easily tempted to strike at that. But don't. If it was to go forward an inch and hold there, then I'd strike. That's a positive bite. When the bream are in the swim, you often get plenty of movement like that. That's it, and it's on. I was just thinking to myself then that the roach had just slowed up. It's the first cast without a bite almost on the drop. And I was just thinking, I wonder if the bream have arrived, and this feels like it could be a bream. Just a slow pull back. Instead of the rod end vibrating vigorously, this is just a sort of slow bend, slow and heavy pulls, which identifies it to me as a bream. There you go. Quite a lively character too. In fact, I'm just going to have to, oh, it looks like the line's gone round its fin. That'll stop its game a little bit. But it's so shallow here, I'm going to have to just walk out a yard. There you go, bream number one. Well, that could mean that we're in for a procession of these now. In fact, I'm going to change immediately to a bigger hook and the worm and caster cocktail. Come on, in you go, me beauty. There's no mistaking these bream with the lunges on the end of the rod, just slow, heavy lunges. And just coax them in. In fact, just ease them in without winding is the best way. And then just wind down to them. Maintain that the line is tight all the time. Don't ever give them any slack line. And then just pull gently. And I mean gently, with keeping your eye on the top of the rod, watching for those sudden lunges. And again, this very, very soft action rod. cushions against the likes of that again then. And it just made another lunge. In fact, I'm going to beat this one in this shallow water. When the bream are coming fast, I sometimes just do away with the landing net and just get the head just to the beach and pick them up. It's much faster than the net. And in match fishing terms, when they come in as fast as what they come in at the moment, then obviously that is a far quicker method of getting the fish. Come on, in you go. They all need just a little bit of guidance. Come on, off you go. Doesn't know where it is. So shallow in the margins here. Go on. That's the way, get into that deeper water at the end of the net. The rod I'm using here today has got a very, very fine tip. You see I'm fishing it parallel with the ground, pointing at the marker board there, but the tip is ever so fine and sensitive. I've actually set just a little bend in the tip so I can watch for bites like that and also drop back bites. However, on the river, then the position of the rod is so much different. Instead of fishing with the rod parallel to the ground, we have the rod right up in the air. And the idea of that is to take as much line off the river surface as possible. Because if we had the rod down, like I'm fishing here on the still water, then there would be so much pull against the line that it would bend the rod tip over enormously. And bites, or fish would feel the resistance. And bites could be difficult to detect. By having the rod up in the air and therefore all the line out of the water, we can also get away with the smallest weight of feeder possible. The idea is that feeder has got to be just heavy enough to hold the bottom in the current. So once again, by having the rod high and keeping that line out of the water, then that allows us to use the lightest feeder possible. In fact, if we just have a 10-minute trip to the river, I'll show you that method in action. The reason why I've picked this particular peg on the river is because of this slack water bay on the far bank. Bream simply love these slacks next to the main flow. And it's next to the main flow in the slack where I'm going to position the feeder. And there you see the rod up in the air. And the reason for that is that I want to keep as much line off the surface of the water as possible. And therefore allowing me to use the smallest weight possible and yet still hold bottom. The secret about this feeder fishing on the river really is about the balanced feeder. And that means to use the smallest amount of weight possible and yet still hold a static bait, still hold it still on that far side in that slack water. Now, certainly you could hold there guaranteed with 2 ounce, but the idea is to hold there with as light as possible of lead. If the tip that is under compression starts to bounce and move, then you know that that feeder is moving. So then simply by adding a little extra weight, or a lot of extra weight, whatever the case may be, the secret is to add just the right amount so the feeder just holds bottom. And then with the rod fishing now under compression, when a fish takes the bait, it often dislodges the feeder and therefore slackens the line and the rod tip comes back out of compression, registering a positive drop back bite. You see the ground bait there, well laced with casters. Always a great holding bait for bream, if and when they appear. Now he's going to position that feeder, cast that feeder right onto the edge of that flow, right on the edge of the slack water. There it goes, perfect. And if we can keep hitting that place time after time, and accuracy in the casting is of course of ultimate importance. The rod now there under compression, waiting for bites, which can be registered in two ways, either by pulling the end of the rod down or by dropping the end of the rod back, which is the most likely type of bait bite that we get as the fish does that, like that. There it goes, See a fish there just took the bait, dislodged the balanced feeder, and the rod dropped back out of compression. Not a very big fish, a roach, but big enough to give a positive bite. In fact, it's such a deadly method, this. I've caught many a tiny fish gudgeon on the River Trent. You know, you can, a big feeder out there in the middle of the river and the rod up in the air, and because that feeder is balanced to the flow, just balanced and just holding bottom, even a little tiny gudgeon can displace that feeder and show that positive drop back bite. There's another little roach, and as usual, it's always the roach that are first on the scene, and with a bit of luck, maybe the bream will appear in a while. What I'm going to have to do is put a big, big bait on, something that hopefully the roach will leave alone. If there are any bream there, then they'll get a chance to pick it up. If you notice, the length of the distance of the feeder to the actual fish is a little bit shorter than that on the lake. And you find that quite often in fairly fast moving water, to shorten that distance, in fact, sometimes we'll even shorten it as much as 9 inches from the feeder to the hook. That is on faster flowing rivers. It's kiting downstream now. It's using its big broad body and this very, very strong flow in the middle of the river. There it is, rolling on the top. But I mustn't let it get too far downstream, especially with these rush beds here. That's it, I've got it swimming upstream now. That's just what I wanted. Keep swimming, me beauty. Whilst this rod is sort of a fairly powerful rod, it's got a nice soft action that actually cushions against these thumps and bumps. This is a lovely bream. Oh, look at that hump. Oh, come here, me beauty. Come on. Let's get his head up and skim it in. There we go. What a cracking fish. There you are. How about that? Just shows you, on the right peg, with the right method, then this fishing's easy. Let's get back to the lake and see how we're progressing there. There he is. It's blown the worm right up the line again. This one's blown the worm up the line as well.